Welcome to your most favorite channel, Heartbeat. This channel is mainly meant for MBBS students and medical professionals. My name is Dr. Amrit Kejriwal, and I am teaching mainly general medicine and applied medicine. As it is said, I learnt a lot from my teachers. I learnt a bit more from my colleagues, but the most I learnt from my students. And I'm still learning, and I still consider myself to be a student of medicine. Today we learn about jaundice, the clinical features and approach. So jaundice is the yellowish discoloration of the body tissues, the deposition of bilirubin. Occurs only in the presence of serum hyperbilirubinemia. Commonly, hyperbilirubinemia is seen with liver disease, hemolysis, and disorders of bilirubin metabolism. So you examine the sclera. It has high affinity of bilirubin, and whenever the bilirubin goes more than 3 milligrams per deciliter, the sclera is yellowish tinge. You can also look for ictus on under surface of the tongue. The skin, depending upon the level of bilirubin, may be yellow or green. Use of quinacrines or exposure to phenol can also lead to color discoloration of the skin to be yellow or greenish. Carotenoidrenoderma is excessive vegetables rich in carotene. So when a person consumes a lot of these vegetables, then there may be yellowish discoloration, but only palms, soles, forehead, nasolabial folds and they are affected. There is total sparing of the sclera. So that is how we can distinguish between them clinically. Also again, color of the urine, mainly seen increased in change, color is changed with hyperbilirubinemia. Now coming to the approach of towards the patient. First of all, you have to take a detailed history. So in history, what are the things we'll ask? First, detailed history. Use of medication and drugs are very common cause for hyperbilirubinemia. Ask for parenteral blood transfusion, tattoo or sexual activity. Travel history or exposure to people with jaundice. History of contaminated food. Occupational exposure commonly seen in medical professionals. Alcohol consumption history. Duration of jaundice. Accompanying signs and symptoms, fever, abdominal pain, etc. So all these have to be taken in consideration while taking the history. Coming to the physical examination. If the patient has temporal wasting, think it to be pancreatic carcinoma or cirrhosis. Patient may have stigmata of liver disease. So this may be seen commonly with gynecomastia, spider nevi, Dupuytren's contracture, Palmar erythema, caput medusa, parotid gland enlargement, testicular atrophy. So all are these are the stigmata of liver disease. If the patient has varicose nodules or cystic erythrosus nodules, then you think of abdominal malignancy. If the patient has jugular venous distension, think of cardiac failure as the cause for hyperbilirubinemia. Right sided pleural effusion, probably advanced cirrhosis. This can be determined clinically. Do the abdominal examination. See if the liver for size and consistency. If there is cirrhosis, there is enlarged left lobe of the liver and is palpable below the Ziffy sternum. It may be associated with enlarged spleen. If the liver is nodular, think of malignancy. If the liver is tender, think of viral alcohol or amyloidosis. Right upper abdomen tenderness suggestive of cholecystitis. Spleen palpable or not palpable has to be checked. Ascites may be present or it may be absent. And ascites may be present with jaundice, cirrhosis or malignancy, or still may be absent with jaundice, cirrhosis or malignancy. Now causes of isolated hyperbilirubinemia means that the liver enzymes are normal. So this can be of two types, indirect hyperbilirubinemia and direct hyperbilirubinemia. So in direct hyperbilirubinemia can be due to the hemolytic disorders, it can be due to ineffective erythropoiesis, it can be due to increased bilirubin production. Increased bilirubin production can be seen in massive blood transfusion or reabsorption of hematoma. There are various drugs which cause isolated hyperbilirubinemia, commonly rifampicin, probenecid, ribavirin, protease inhibitors. The inherited conditions and direct hyperbilirubinemia the other causes. So inherited conditions for unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia are Crigler type 1, type 2 and Gilbert's. And direct hyperbilirubinemia is caused by Dubin-Johnson and Ross. There are hepatocellular conditions that may produce jaundice. Viral hepatitis, Epstein-Barr, cytomegalo, herpes simplex virus, alcoholic hepatitis, chronic liver disease and cirrhosis, one of the most important causes. Drug toxicity and environmental toxicity are also causing hepatocellular toxicity. Predictable and dose dependent can be seen with acetaminophen. Unpredictable idiosyncratic can be seen with isoniazide. Environmental toxins can be seen with vinyl chloride, Jamaica bush tree, pyrazoline alkaloids, kava kava, wild mushrooms, amanita phalloides and verna. Wilson's disease, another common cause, and autoimmune hepatitis. Cholestatic conditions that may produce jaundice such as intrahepatic. So these can be viral hepatitis, alcoholic hepatitis, drug toxicity and primary biliary cholangitis. So coming to the viral hepatitis, hepatitis B and C can cause fibrosing cholestatic hepatitis that may produce jaundice. Hepatitis A, Epstein-Barr virus, cytomegalovirus can cause cholestatic jaundice. Then drugs such as anabolic and contraceptive steroids can cause cholestatic jaundice. Cholestatic hepatitis can be caused by clorpromazine, isoniazid. Chronic cholestasis can be caused by clorpromazine and prochlorperazine. Then again, the cholestatic conditions can be caused by primary sclerosing cholangitis or vanishing bile duct syndrome. The vanishing bile duct syndrome can be seen in chronic rejection of liver transplant, sarcoidosis, drugs. Congestive hepatomegaly and ischemic hepatitis can also cause cholestatic hepatitis. Inherited conditions such as progressive familial intrahepatic cholestasis and benign recurrent intrahepatic cholestasis can are inherited conditions. Total parental nutrition another cause. Non-hepatic hepatobiliary sepsis, benign postoperative cholestasis, paraneoplastic syndromes, veno-occlusive disease, graft versus host disease, infiltrative disease such as tuberculosis, lymphoma, amyloidosis, infections such as malaria and leptospirosis. Now coming to the approach towards the patient. First of all, you have to take a detailed history. So in history, what are the things we'll ask? First, detailed history. Use of medication and drugs. Benign conditions. Colitis, post-operative biliary strictures, primary sclerosing cholangitis, chronic pancreatitis, AIDS cholangiopathy, Merzi syndrome and parasitic disease can cause benign extrahepatic cholestasis. Now coming to the approach. So when a patient comes to you examine him and you find that he's a critic, you have taken the detailed history and now we've gone the various causes. So how to approach the patient clinically? History on focus on medication and drugs. Physical examination, as mentioned, do the lab test, bilirubin fractionation, liver enzymes, alkaline phosphatase, both thrombin time and albumin. So we'll get if it's isolated hyperbilirubinemia, other liver function tests are also deranged. If there's isolation elevation of the bilirubin, that is the direct hyperbilirubinemia greater than 15%, then it's probably inherited conditions such as Dubin-Johnson's or Rotor's. In direct hyperbilirubinemia less than 15%, drugs such as rifampicin or probenecid. Inherited disorders such as Gilbert's and Crigler-Najjar, hemolytic disorders, ineffective erythropoiesis, if bilirubin and other liver tests all are elevated, then you look for hepatocellular pattern, ALT, AST elevated out of proportion to alkaline phosphatase. Okay, so we do the viral serologies, hepatitis A IgM, hepatitis B surface antigen, core antibody, hepatitis C RNA. Do the toxicological screening, acetaminophen levels. If the above tests are negative, you may have to do the serum seroplasmin level. If patient is less than 40 years of age, look for Wilson's disease. And ANAs, SMA and SPEP are further tests that may be required. And if negative, then what is to be done? You have to do the additional virological testings. Cytomegalovirus DNA, Epstein-Barr virus capsid antigen, hepatitis D antibody if indicated, hepatitis E IgM if indicated. If required, if all are negative, to go ahead with a liver biopsy. If the patient has a cholestatic pattern, that is alkaline phosphatase is out of proportion of liver enzymes, then do a USG. You may see dilated ducts, extrahepatic cholestasis, it's suggestive of. Then you do a CT or MRCP or ERCP. If the ducts are not dilated, then you do serological test, anti-mitochondrial antibodies, hepatitis serologies, hepatitis A, CMV, Epstein-Barr virus, and review the drugs. If all these results are negative, then you do a MRCP or liver biopsy. If these results are positive, then still you may require a liver biopsy.